Okay, today let us discuss about Cori cycle. Before that, how the energy is released for muscle contraction, what is the role of the phosphocreatine. First, the hydrolysis of ATP generally takes place releasing energy. That is processed by the enzyme myosin ATPase, releasing ADP plus inorganic phosphate plus energy. However, when the energy is required very fast in the muscle while doing the exercise and the working muscle needs more energy, in that case this inorganic phosphate will combine with creatine, with the help of creatine kinase, to form phosphocreatine. The phosphocreatine or creatine phosphate combines with ADP, again it stores the energy, excess energy, which is produced by the ATP hydrolysis, that is stored in this phosphocreatine or creatine phosphate as ATP in the contractile muscles. Whenever it is needed, again it will be giving the energy and the creatine will be separating, here will be separated. That reaction is done by creatine and phosphate. Okay, so phosphocreatine is the energy source for few seconds during muscle contraction in the working muscle for the release of the energy. It will trap that excess energy produced by the ATP and it will store in that phosphocreatine. Okay, so again muscle contraction to form the ATP, again the ATP will be formed and it will release the creatine. And coming to muscle fatigue, repeated contractions of the skeletal muscle during the absence of the oxygen, that is anaerobically, accumulates lactic acid, because lactic acid will be formed in the absence of oxygen in the muscle. So here what happens, the muscle glycogen present in the muscle releases small amount of energy by producing muscle lactic acid. Thus that lactic acid again will be transferred to the liver through the blood. It will be transported to the liver through the blood. Then again that lactic acid will be oxidized. 20% will be oxidized, releasing CO2 and H2O and energy. And that will be again converted to glycogen. First glucose, next glycogen. Like that, gluconeogenesis will take place. 80% of it will be converted into glycogen. Again that glycogen will be converted to glucose and again it will be reaching the muscle. So this is called lactic acid cycle or Cori cycle, because it is described by Cori and Cori. So here the transfer of the lactic acid in muscle and the transfer of glucose from liver to the muscle is involved in Cori cycle. Transfer of lactic acid formed in the muscle to the liver, and again transfer of glucose from liver to the muscle. It prevents the accumulation of lactic acid in the muscle. So accumulation of acid will be prevented by the Cori cycle. Then what is rigor mortis? Extreme rigidity of the body after death is called rigor mortis. That happens because of the complete depletion of ATP and phosphocreatine also. Generally, in smooth muscle fibers, where they are present in visceral organs, the contraction starts very, very more slowly and it lasts for longer time. It sustains for longer time. That too, it is under the control of autonomic nervous system. So, in response to autonomic nervous system, the muscle contracts, contraction starts very slowly and it will last for longer time. Whereas in cardiac muscles, the structure of cardiac muscle will be like skeletal muscle. The gap junctions present in the cardiac muscle spread the action potential from one muscle fiber to another muscle fiber, and a single muscle fiber here stimulates the all the other muscle fibers. It acts like network, so it acts as functional unit. Coming to the two types of muscle fibers, red muscle fibers and white muscle fibers, they are dark red in color, red muscle fibers, due to red myoglobin is present. Again, that will combine with oxygen to form oxymyoglobin, and white fibers will be lighter in color. There is no myoglobin, and more mitochondria, here less mitochondria. More blood capillaries are present in red muscle fibers, whereas less blood capillaries are present. Less sarcoplasmic reticulum present here, and more sarcoplasmic reticulum will be present here. Aerobic respiration, no lactic acid formation here, and anaerobic respiration accumulate more lactic acid. They contract for longer period without any fatigue, whereas during strenuous work they get fatigued very soon. Fatigue means tiresome. Slow rate of contraction for longer periods, fast rate of contraction for shorter periods. And for example, red muscle fibers are present in extensor muscles of the back of human being and also the flight muscles of the kites, whereas here the white muscle fibers are present in eyeball muscles, which will be fatigued more if they undergo strenuous work. If you see mobile, if you read for longer time, eyeball muscles will get fatigued, like flight muscles of sparrow also. They become more fatigued if they fly more. So, after muscular system, we have to pass on to the skeletal system. Just the supportive, protective, jointed framework of the body forms the skeleton. Hardest structures, they're hard or flexible. They may be internal or external. And bones and cartilage, generally, they form the skeleton in the body. They're responsible for movements and locomotions of the various body parts. There are two types of skeletal systems, known as exoskeletal system and endoskeletal system. Exoskeletal skeletal structures are rigid, protective, they're hard, they cover the outside of the body. And endoskeletal system, they are present inside the body. They form hard supporting framework inside the body. They give support, and generally the bones and cartilage will form the endoskeletal structures. So tomorrow let us proceed in the next session about the endoskeletal system in man. Thanks for